be so comfortable, but Nas, they eat like comfort food. To disregard the bogus claims and pseudoscientific claims, can you imagine just how much indeed the world would change? No more political predators playing on the populace, but ilkas and plots to shift and kill Metropolis. No more villains with the title in the Bible, holding phony temper Bibles like the stuff they teach is vital. Imagine it was normal to have to prove a claim you make, and folks really feel ashamed expressing content that was fake. It's not to say we never make mistakes, it's just to say we go out of our way to show the evidence it takes.
Remain skeptical while you travel the world or even stay strapped with logic and facts. That's what it is, yo. Keep reality intact. Help the truth, bro. Question every claim, especially the ones you believe in. Remain skeptical while you travel the road to reason.
Welcome, everyone, to Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century. My name is David Tamayo, president of Hispanic American Freethinkers, and today I have the pleasure and honor to be with
Kayla Terzak. I'm not the president of anything.
So yet.
I'm just a skeptical thinker, trying to be a skeptical thinker.
But after this show, you might want to run for president.
Oh, president?
Of the country.
There's a lot of people running for president.
Well, just don't join the Republican side.
I'm going to be Democrat. I have more chance of winning, so.
Well, less people, in less competition there. And today we're going to have Nando. But Nando couldn't come today
because
he had some family issues. But today I want to make sure, before we get going, and just as a disclaimer, I want to make sure that people know that I am not a criminal, I'm not a drug runner, and I'm certainly not a rapist. In case I understand that maybe Donald Trump might be watching the show, and I am not Mexican, although I've been called Mexican many times. Basically, if you're from Latin America, you're Mexican, you know, and so just warning so you can feel safe.
Okay.
All right.
All right.
I'm sure you were nervous.
I know you pretty well, and I've always wondered, but I'm glad that I know now.
Now you'll take my word for it, right?
Yeah.
All right. So before we go on, I wanted to mention that we have a person of the week.
Mm-hmm.
And the person of the week this time is David Williamson. And why is he our person of the week? He is suing the Brevard County in Florida, along with a bunch of other folks. And basically what it is the county has been doing prayers, but they prevent anyone that is not a monotheistic religion to come and pray. So if you're a Jew or a Muslim, or fine, if you're a Hindu, if you're a Wiccan, or if you're a humanist, then you're not allowed to deliver a prayer, which is very different than the case in Greece and New York, where the Supreme Court said that you are allowed to pray all you want, just make sure that everyone is included.
Mm-hmm.
So what they're doing here is giving privilege to one religion.
Really is active discrimination.
Yes.
Honestly, I mean, that's something that anybody would be upset about if you're not one of those major monotheistic religions. And I doubt there's a lot of Muslims up there, even though they're monotheistic, praying for the community.
It's not only religious privilege, but it's Christian privilege. They say monotheistic again, like you said, knowing very well that this is just going to have only the people that are Christian in general. And, they'll be willing to accept, Catholics and Protestants and Presbyterians and Southern Baptists and whatever. But
they're inclusive, right?
Yeah, they're
including
inclusive.
All Christian denominations.
But I want to mention the
44,000 in total, actually.
44,000 what?
Christian denominations.
Oh, okay. So they can say, hey.
Any of those Christian denominations are good.
Can come in. They're not discriminating then, right? That's probably the argument. In fact, the reason, of course, that this lawsuit is moving forward is because they were warned, they were told they were discriminating, they were told that this is not right, that it's illegal, and they still want to go through with it. And so the problem is that the people in the county are the ones that are going to have to pay for that.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to mention a couple of other names, Keith Becker and Chase Hansel, and two other people that didn't want to be named because they don't want to be discriminated. But also the humanist community of the Space Coast and Space Coast Free Thought Association, as well as the Central Florida Free Thought community. Everybody's getting together to bring this case. So it's not just one individual somewhere that is not content.
Mm-hmm.
This is, it's a bigger thing. And if we did this across the country more often and really stopped.
We do want to set a precedent. We want to set a precedent of equality in thought, equality in, practice of religion or not practice of religion. Honestly, I think that, favoring one Christian denomination even over another, how many Jehovah's Witnesses are getting up there, how many Mormons are getting up there. I disagree with Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses, but are they going to be discriminated against?
Yep. So before something else, we have to do a joke of the week.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so I'm going to ask you a question and see if you think it's funny.
Okay.
So what do a Christmas tree and a Catholic priest have in common? A Christmas tree and a Catholic priest have in common?
They're overrated?
Not so funny.
Okay.
All right. So the answer is that their balls are just for decoration.
That's so great. We'll not always, though.
Yeah, exactly. That's when the problems come into play. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so I have a couple of announcements because I really want to get to the news part.
Mm-hmm.
The announcements that I have is that I want everyone watching this show to help out the public station that we're doing this on. And so please contact us and offer your donation, $10, $20, anything you want. It'd be greatly appreciated. It's what helps us have the show in the air for basically no fee. Mm-hmm. And also, I want to remind people that, yes, and there's in your screen, you have how to write that check. And you can send it for $1,000 if you want. It's tax deductible. It's a nonprofit organization, so please help out as best you can. And second, I want to remind everyone that next month, in about 3 weeks, the regional atheist conference in Puerto Rico is going to be happening. It's already shaping to be an excellent, outstanding conference. And as I said before, no one parties like the Puerto Ricans. So the music is going to be good. The people are warm and friendly. And the weather is just fantastic. The beaches are amazing. So if you can make it, it's not as expensive as you look. Just go on and go on the internet and find, and you'll see that the cheapest prices are not as expensive as you think you are. So getting there is not that expensive. Those are the two. Do you have any announcements besides?
I don't have any. We have a new president for the Hispanic America Free Thinkers.
A new director.
Yeah, we have a new director on the board. Her name's Adriana.
Say it.
I can't say her last name.
Adriana.
I'm so sorry.
Buenaventura.
Buenaventura.
Very good. Adriana Buenaventura. She is the new member of the board of directors at Hispanic American Freethinkers. So Road to Reason wants to thank her and congratulate her on being part of that organization. And I'm sure they're going to make her work very hard. Mm-hmm. The other thing I wanted to mention, because I brought my special tie for the topic today.
And I brought my special shirt, which is not anything to do with the topic, but.
Well, maybe it's less biased. Mm-hmm. I'm selling patriotism.
I'm
here,
being
which
neutral.
Is kind of like a religion also, mm-hmm. Sometimes.
Can be.
So the piece of news that we want to talk about, you want to mention what it's about?
Apparently, a guy named David Deladon went undercover at Planned Parenthood and took a bunch of footage over the last 3 years or so and came out with this video. The biggest thing that happened within that video was a discussion that he recorded without the permission of the doctors involved of the price that that people pay for the fetuses involved in abortions. So one of the things that it discussed in some of the articles that we were reading discussed was that in any kind of organ donation, for instance, if you donate blood, there's fees involved. The only person who doesn't benefit, as you said before, is the person actually donating the blood, for instance. And so I think that a lot, when they were discussing the fees involved, based on what I saw, it looked like they were discussing, it wasn't that expensive. It didn't seem like they were actually going to gain a huge profit off of these
fees. Yeah, I think it was like $30 to $100, which I doubt it covered.
Which was the issue. The issue for legality. I mean, there was the moral issue, obviously, if people, this is so similar to, there's the moral issue, but there's also the legal issue. Mm-hmm. We have that legal issue of is it legal to gain profit off of an abortion?
Yeah, I mean, I understand that it's for shipping and handling and storage. Mm-hmm. There's a cost to that. Shipping is very expensive.
Yeah.
And when I first heard about this, my concern was that they were doing this without the consent of the woman that had the abortion. But it turns out that the woman gives consent. And that this tissue is necessary or is used in institutions for research in development. And so really the only part that I see that is seems to be unethical maybe, and more needs to come out on that, is that the tissue that the doctor doing the abortion sometimes has to pick do a certain type of abortion so as to not destroy certain tissues.
And it might not be beneficial for the person and for the woman who's getting an abortion.
Exactly. So that's the question. So, is it safe? Safer? Is it the same? Is it a safe? Mm-hmm. You know. And now, do you have any other issues? I mean, how different is it than when your uncle dies and you want to donate his eyes to science?
I think that there is a difference in issue. I think the issue that I have, and I might still have a lot of emotional reaction to it based off of, you know, I was religious for a very long time, and so I do see that as, it's hard for me not to see that as a human life and profiting off of an unborn human life. And I know that part of that is just an emotional reaction to
profit, though. You said profit. So yeah, if they profit, it's incorrect.
Yeah.
If bad, if they profit. And also, it comes to personhood. You know, are they, you know, is that tissue a human person or not? Mm-hmm. And I mean, blood, obviously, we can agree that blood is not a person.
Yeah.
Even though it contains human DNA.
I think the issue for me is when it comes to morality, and you know, I don't think that we've developed morality in order to be moral towards, let's say, a dog, but we have tendency to extend a lot of our moral tendencies to animals because they are very similar to us. We can recognize certain emotions that seem that we can recognize in each other. So we have our more sense of morality in order to help us determine how we're going to treat each other. Right. So when it comes to situations where we're talking about something that you can't have I don't know, like, is this something that is moral? Is it causing us to devalue each other's human life? Yeah. Not extending or not respecting what is happening in an abortion? Is it causing us to devalue human life?
And the question becomes, once an abortion is done, and if we agree that the abortion is legal and properly done, should that tissue be thrown out or be used for science, especially with everyone's consent?
Yeah.
And that's, you know, anyway, we're out of time. I think we need to go now to a PSA, and then we're going to come back with tons of things. Please call in with any questions or comments. And we already had some questions that people sent us. And so we'll mention those people that sent us mail already.
Good.
Homemade noodles. Oh. Marty, stop it. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. It reminds me, I've been thinking maybe we should try a new form of birth control. I heard about this one, it's called the IUD, intrauterine device. Or we could try the patch on your arm. Actually, I think that one goes in your butt.
Bedsider.org has birth control information and a lot more. And it's...
What do you think, though? Arm or the butt?
There's a lot of tree branches and dry brush over here. We should probably move the bonfire over there.
I'm guessing Smokey liked that idea.
This is Richard Dawkins. Doing commercials is unfamiliar territory for me, but I'm inviting you to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century, on Fairfax Public Access every Sunday. Each week, the hosts tackle wishful thinking, religion, pseudoscience, and the harm they cause, with a combination of facts, humor, and community involvement. They challenge believers to defend their faith and give you, the skeptic, a voice. With live call-ins for viewers and streaming on the World Wide Web, there's never a dull moment. Don't wait. Look at them now on Facebook and YouTube, and remember to watch Road to Reason, a skeptic's guide to the 21st century. Or they'll be hell to pay.
I love those PSAs. I love
especially
them
the first one. You were cracking up during that.
You know, I've only seen like once before, and still hilarious.
I'm just all like, man, that's so awkward to put on public television. I don't know.
But it conveys. I think it conveys the right message. It captures people's attention, and I think that's important.
Yeah.
But anyway, welcome back to Road to Reason, Skeptics Guide to the 21st Century. So the topic for today is going to be politics and religion.
Mm-hmm.
It's a topic we can spend months, years talking about. I mean, there are people that have made careers about talking about these two topics. So we're not going to cover everything. We're not going to talk about the economy or things like that. We're going to try to look a little bit at the intersection of religion with politics and see how that affects us, because that's part of what this show does. And there's so much, I mean, so much to talk about that we're going to run out of things, mm-hmm. Run out of time for that. So why don't I ask you the first question to you and see what you think. And it's, why are we doing this topic today and not 2 years from now?
Oh, it's a really important topic. What was that quote that you got?
Very good.
That was a really good quote.
Why don't you read the quote?
Yeah, so David G. McFree. Say that right?
I don't know.
He recently was quoted as saying, you know what they say, never discuss religion or politics. That is, of course, unless you want to engage in a discussion about the most important topics for any for now or any generation.
So he nailed it right on the head. It's most people tell you don't talk about politics and religion, mm-hmm. not at parties, not at work, not anywhere else. Yet those things are the most important things that we have in our society, because it affects us at many different levels. You have religion on the one side that I consider to be imaginary stuff that often guides people into what they do in the politics, and the politics then affects all of us, mm-hmm. whether it's taxes or not paying taxes, or whether it's accessing, having more freedoms over your body or not, or whatever. There's that involvement of religion and politics, and it's mm-hmm. and makes people uncomfortable. But I think there's a way to look at this, and these are things that we have to talk about so we can inform ourselves. And when we go vote, we don't just go vote on a single issue like a lot of mm-hmm. voters do.
I think the problem is that a lot of people have they have an emotional reaction to it, and it's hard to have a conversation without getting angry if somebody disagrees with you about something that you really believe you really believe in what you believe, mm-hmm. and so it's difficult to have an honest, open conversation where you might change what you think. Mm-hmm. So we do have a caller. Toen Sola is on the phone.
Toen Sola, oh, welcome, my friend. I long time no see.
Hi. Hi there.
Hi. So what do you have for us today?
What's your question?
I really have no question. I just wanted to talk about religion and politics.
Okay.
I guess it is important that the secular community is very aware of the importance of religion in politics, especially presidential politics. I mean, looking at all these candidates,
please,
how they use religion.
Toen, turn down the volume on your side, just to make sure that we're getting some feedback.
Yeah, it's a little bit hard to hear.
Completely mute. My computer's completely mute.
Oh wow. Okay. Cool. So continue. You were saying that it's important to discuss politics and religion.
I think we might.
Politics and religion. I hope he calls back.
Yeah.
It sounds like he was going to have something
I know him. He works with the humanists of Puerto Rico.
Oh, you
and
know.
So he's actually calling from Puerto Rico.
Oh, he's calling from Puerto Rico.
He was a previous guest in the show some months ago.
Did we interview him?
Because
I remember interviewing somebody about
I'm not sure if you were the co-host at that time, but yeah, he's
we interviewed, was it him and a woman that we were interviewing
I interviewed him alone. But since we can talk about some of the emails that we got. So why don't we talk about Phil Robinson? So mm-hmm. Phil Robinson is someone who I keep in touch on the internet. Someone that makes good questions. And so here's his comment, and we can talk a little bit about it. Scientific illiteracy is a big problem, contributing to many social and economic problems. Many churches teach science denial that prevents people from learning. So it sounds like part of the problem with religion and politics mm-hmm. is that a lot of churches teach anti-science. They teach, if anything that contradicts the holy book, you need to abandon. It doesn't matter if it makes planes fly. Mm-hmm. You need to abandon it and not trust it. And so mm-hmm. I think we've grown to have this very anti-science society, especially in some parts of our political spectrum.
I think that is the case. On top of that, you know, when you are talking about a public institution like a public school, we're talking about a place where very different people are convening to discuss topics that we are teaching them are real. So if you bring in, for instance, I believe it was a while ago, and I'm not going to get this factually correct, but it was a while ago they were having some issues with Texas bringing in the Moses story as fact in history. Like, they were putting it in their history books. Yeah. Well, what you're doing is, first of all, that's favoring the, you know, Abrahamic religions.
Not to mention it's not true. There's no evidence.
And it's not true. I mean, that's the biggest thing is, like, when any religion could step in and say, okay, we have this belief.
Teach my dogma.
You must teach my dogma as well.
As history.
As fact. And I don't think anybody's actually taking issue with teaching things like, let's say, the creationist story in a religion class.
Or even a social studies class.
Or social studies class.
Teach religion. I'm for teaching every religion in school, but teach it in a social studies setting, not in a science setting, because it doesn't belong in the science.
You know what's really funny? I was talking to this lady the other day. She used to be my teacher, my Spanish teacher, in my Christian high school. And so she doesn't know where I was at. And she said to me, she said, you know, they just passed a law in London that they have to teach religion in schools. They're realizing that religion needs to be back in schools. And I told her, well, I don't know much about this law, but I'm pretty sure England has, like, you know, Great Britain has always had some kind of religious studies class. I think that is standard.
It's part of the government.
Schools.
The government pays for church in England. The Church of England is paid by the government.
I think they have a religious studies class in high schools. I'm pretty sure that's something that is the case.
Yeah.
So I'm like, I told her that. I was like, they. And, you know, I even said it like this. I was like, well, yeah, actually, I think it's really important to teach religion in schools. I mean, I want you probably want, you know, Muslim children to learn about Christianity, and they probably want Christianity. They want their children to learn.
And anyone
your children
feel,
learn about
anyone
Islam.
That feels strongly about it, they can go to church and learn it there.
It was just really funny because the look on her face was like, oh gosh, they're gonna like have my kids. Like, if we do this in school, my kids are gonna learn about Islam.
Yes, and so that's the thing.
She didn't realize
always,
that's what she was saying.
It's always good to teach religion in school up until the time they're not teaching your religion.
Mm-hmm.
Once they teach somebody else's religion, then that's not good.
But she wanted it for political reasons. It wasn't just religious reasons. I mean, if you think you want this conservative religious, you know, idea to be taught in schools, but she didn't even realize that what
she was
saying.
Sharia law.
What she was saying, what she was saying was actually, you know, opening up the doors to her children learning about Islam, which was something that she
didn't want.
Necessarily
I
appreciate.
I see. All right, so one more. This question comes from me, and we'll continue with the other questions.
Mm-hmm.
So why you and I, why you and me, why are we here talking about this instead of somebody else? More, not, I mean, I'm the first one to say I know very little about politics and religion.
Mm-hmm.
I don't consider you to be an eminence in that area, but
I know quite a bit about religion, especially, you know, certain forms of Christianity.
One religion, yeah.
But I'm definitely not an expert, and I think that's the point. You know, we're not experts, and we're trying to encourage other people who are not experts to have this conversation.
Yes.
So don't take it from us. What we say today, don't take it from us, please. We're average Joes.
Yes,
and James.
The idea is for us is that you see that we don't know as much as you. We have as many questions as anyone does, and to have people go and search and learn it, and not be voting on a single issue. Because a lot of the problem is people say, "Oh yeah, I'm against abortion, so I'm going to go vote for this candidate," or "I'm against gun control, and I'm going to go vote." You know. Let's not be a one-issue voter and look at all the different issues. Now, again, today we're talking about religion and politics because those two things seem to be the things that are mostly avoided at parties or things like that. So why don't you read the next...
Okay. So Tyler Jacob Chott, he states that a lot of people are saying, knowingly, maybe serious, that Trump is a plant, but by the Democrat, a plant put in by the Democrats, but a case could be made that every Republican candidate are just planted to disrupt the Republican Party. You could talk about who is the most moderate or sane of them and how they don't have a chance. So what he's saying is like he's wondering how serious the Republican Party actually is, the candidates in that party.
All right.
Are any of them serious?
I want to make sure that we don't appear to be taking sides in here. We're here to question everybody, and we're going to go through and mention all the different mm-hmm. sort of negatives and positives. We want to be skeptical about it. So, but this is, let me give you some statistics that I've compiled per se. We have five Democrats that are running for office. And that's Chafee, which is from my home state mm-hmm. Where I was born, where I was raised in Rhode Island, Lincoln Chafee. He actually used to be a Republican that changed to Democrat. Mm-hmm. You don't see that fairly often. You have Hillary Clinton, you have O'Malley, who's from Maryland, our sort of local guy. We have Bernie Sanders, who's from Vermont and you know, seems to be coming fast, picking up steam. Mm-hmm. The old crazy guy, as some people refer to him, but seems to be attracting a lot of people. And then we have Jim Webb, who's here from Virginia. Mm-hmm. And not running is, of course, Warren and Biden, who some people wanted to run because they seem, you know, like good candidates. Now, and the Republicans, I'm not going to go through the list. There are 16 Republicans running.
27? 34?
Well, 16 as of right now, but who knows an hour mm-hmm. from now. They seem to be grabbing everybody from everywhere. But what's interesting is that you would expect someone like Jeb Bush, who's had a father and a grandfather, presidential, and all the machinery and money and everything in place, or you would have Rick Perry or some of these more seasoned people to be leading the Republican Party at this point. Mm-hmm. But who do you think is leading the Republican Party?
I could not tell you. Not Jeb Bush.
Not Jeb Bush, but it is Donald Trump. That's why I had the little thing. Donald Trump. And so it seems to be that Americans, or at least a portion of the Republican Party,
are attracted to, like, comb-overs.
That's it. Yeah. Is that thing in its head? I don't know what it is, but is that thing? No, he is a self-made man, some argue. Not really. He was born into a lot of money. And he's declared bankruptcy six times and has gotten back on his feet. But he is a very interesting guy. I find that he is perhaps the most honest guy that we have there, although he contradicts himself. You'll find videos that he'll say Hillary is great.
He's honestly contradicting himself.
There you go. So he's a real, and of course, you know, I said that at the beginning about rapists, because he was the one that came out when he announced that he was becoming president. He said he's becoming president to stop the illegal immigration, and because they're drug dealers, rapists, and bad mm-hmm. guys altogether, which statistics show that they're not, they're in fact probably a little bit less than the regular, you know, mm-hmm. population as mm-hmm. a whole. And so, percentage-wise. So, therefore, he seems to be, so Trump, the part is that he, if you watch him, he's really entertaining. Mm-hmm. If you watch him on TV, you'll see that he just says whatever comes to his mind, and he's unrepentant. So that's the other interesting thing.
He's certainly entertaining.
He's that reality show guy, and he's been doing a reality show, The Apprentice.
But the things that come out of his mouth, though. I don't know. I watched like a 10-minute clip of some of the things that he was saying. There was no commentary whatsoever, and I'm just all like, I don't understand. It's just drivel. I could imagine him just drool. I don't know.
Oh, I mean,
that's just me being biased, maybe. But I'm just like, this guy. Why is he saying anything now?
A lot of people look at him and say, this is a guy that has actually made a lot of money. Maybe he can do the same mm-hmm. with the whole country. Mm-hmm. But he tends to alienate a lot of people. And the party right now is trying to attract the Latinos, for instance. And saying this thing about Latinos or Mexicans...
It's just Mexicans, right?
Well, I'm not sure he could tell the difference between a Mexican and a Latino. So they, with him, the idea, he's... I think what a lot of people saw, he's the new Sarah Palin of mm-hmm. the Republican Party. A lot of people see him that way. And he did say a comment on religion. Mm-hmm. Which attracted me. He basically, they asked him, you know, he went to a conference, all the family, blah, blah, mm-hmm. blah. And they said, they asked him, do you take communion? Do you take, you know, he says, yeah, I drink wine. You know, the only time I drink wine is when I go there and have the little wine and the little cracker. Well, no one ever that is religious ever refers to the communion. In fact, they call it the Holy Communion as a cracker.
If they're Catholic, they don't, but... I've called it cracker.
Like a cracker. And they asked him, have you accepted Jesus? Have you ever repented? He said, no, I just do things better again. A lot of people were not very excited. Well, a lot of the Republican side has been very used to pandering to religious, to mm-hmm. the religious side.
And he's not pandering.
He's not at all. So I like that about him. He's not pandering to the religious people. And
pandering to anybody.
He seems to be very honest. And he's thinking about doing a third party. And the Republicans are very scared about that.
The Trump Party.
The Trump Party.
We're going to Trump you.
Anyway. I think on the phone.
Yep, we got Toen again. Hi, Toen.
Hi there. Hi. Okay, hopefully I'll have a better connection now.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it sounds a lot better. Excellent.
Yeah. I'm really glad you're already talking about Trump and, you know, about the GOP race. Let me tell you, this Donald Trump guy, you know, he's just there because of popularity. I mean, every rational person knows that it's eventually going to go to the moderate establishment candidate. It's going to be Bush or Walker, most likely. The religious factor is obviously very important for many candidates, Santorum, Huckabee, Cruz, who happens to be very mild against Trump because he is, of course, waiting for Trump to flame out to get a lot of those
votes to him. That makes sense.
I guess it's okay, and it gets a lot of ratings to talk about Trump now, but, you know, Herman Cain was from Tufts, 2012, Michelle Bachmann, Rick Santorum, Gingrich.
There's a difference,
you know,
though.
Stay bombastic thing.
So, Tolin, there's a difference there. The difference is that he can actually finance his own campaign and outspend everybody else because
absolutely.
You know, last I heard, he was worth about $10 billion.
Hmm. So even he's overestimating himself. Forbes and other reputable companies say otherwise, but yes, it's true. And what is interesting about the Trump phenomenon is that it really does allow the people that do study political science to look at, wow, these kind of ideas are getting this kind of attention. And it's really going to help other candidates to look for votes in places that, you know, it was not thought that you could find those.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what David was saying earlier. He was saying that, you know, it's interesting because it seems like Donald Trump is one of those characters that the Republicans, if you watch, you know, Fox News, they're creating characters like these. So it makes sense that these characters will start running for president, actually doing something. So,
you know, in the last 2012, a lot of the Republicans were not happy about Mitt Romney. They were usually not happy with him. You will always find support in the country for going against Washington politicians, against, you know, all that mess Trump is saying. It's always going to find some, but at the end of the day, it's going to be an establishment candidate that's
The interesting
I don't think he's going to win either.
Yeah, the interesting part is that right now, today, mm-hmm. he is the most popular Republican candidate by two or three times more than the next one.
The people just like comb-overs.
Twice, actually, at 20% stake. And the other candidate is 14%.
Exactly, so twice.
So, yes,
twice as much.
Really?
Yes.
Incredible, but
so he's, that's an incredible lead. Now, in Virginia, just to give you some, in Virginia, for the primaries, people can vote, anyone can vote, whether you're a Republican or a Democrat or an independent, whatever, you can go vote at the primaries. There's a lot of states that are like that, and I've heard that there are some people that are Democrat or that actually don't like Trump, that are going to go vote for him to be the candidate. Not to mention that every comedian loves him because, you know, he provides so much beautiful material.
I thought
everybody loves Trump right now. The media loves Trump. He gets lots of ratings. He says a lot of crazy things.
Yes,
he's amazing for the press. He's amazing for everybody.
He loves the limelight.
Have you ever watched Red Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy?
No.
It's a funny book, but it's, you know.
A movie.
Or a movie, whatever. But one of the primary goals of the presidency for the universe, apparently, in this book, is that they have to be a flagrant character who can get into a lot of trouble to distract from the actual
topics and the actual themes of what's going on. Yeah.
Yeah. So everybody thinks he has all this power, and he's really just like
screwed. Absolutely. But one of the horrible things that I guess we've all learned about this Trump phenomenon is how many people still cling to the idea of hating the Mexican, Latino community, calling them, you know, all sorts of names.
Yeah.
It is appalling, but at the end of the day, it does help us have a clear picture of the people that are supporting the GOP.
And that's the reason I like, and thank you for calling. I like to think that the nice thing about Trump is that he's bringing up these topics that no one wants to talk about. Mm-hmm. No one wants to talk about immigration, Republicans or Democrats, neither one. They don't want to talk about it because there are no easy solutions, and you can't come up with a solution in a soundbite in 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is they want to see him gone. They want him not to to stop running because it makes everybody uncomfortable. And I think we see that a little bit with Bernie Sanders running in the Democratic side, who he is, by his own admission or his own calling, someone that is a socialist with a lot of social mm-hmm. leanings. He's always been that way, but he seems to be attracting and taking a lot of votes and forcing the conversations on certain things, mm-hmm. on big money. Certain freedoms that we've been losing, about wars and so forth. So all of those things need to be brought up to the table to be discussed. In the last election, when Romney was running, for instance, there was a group of scientists that wanted to have a discussion on science. Mm-hmm. And where does everybody stand on science? And should the president follow more a science advisory board or a religious board? Because, you know, every Monday, every president since Reagan has met in the White House every Monday with a group of about 12 religious people who advise him on what to do or what not to do. And that's ridiculous.
Really?
Because they all have magic on their hand. And then for science advisor, he's got like one or two guys doing this. And we should be a science-driven society more than an imaginary,
Or even society. Like arts and humanities. Like, I think that one thing that you're seeing in general, even on the uber-progressive college campus style, like, mm-hmm. Progressivism, a lot of times you see a lot of arts and humanities thinking that doesn't take and consider, it doesn't know how to handle statistics, for instance. I mean, sometimes I look at the statistics that people bring up, like 77 cents to a dollar, that's how much women, I mean, there is a pay gap, but it's not 77 cents to a dollar, because people don't know how to read the actual reports on these statistics. They're not reading their methods or seeing how things work, because they're taught to, I was an English major, I was taught to see things through the eyes of oppression.
He presides one of the subcommittees on science in the Senate, and he is a climate science denier.
And that's a problem with politics. Excellent. All right.
One of those things, right?
Well, okay. Thank you, Tolin, for calling. We'll let you go. We're going to go to the next question that we have here from that was written to us. This was written by Faisal Saeed Al-Mutar.
This one was interesting.
And it says, what does it say there?
It says, is.
Is.
He's making a statement, a philosophical statement about what is, because what is what is.
Well, I remember one of the presidents who was being accused of certain philandering mm-hmm. saying, it all depends on your definition of is.
Yeah.
What is the definition of
is?
And so... Faisal. Faisal is a friend of mine.
I'm just ragging on him. We ask for questions or comments.
You put ISIS. I don't know if you join ISIS, if you oppose ISIS, if you approve of ISIS, if you.
We'll do a show on ISIS, maybe. I don't know.
Is it Sisi, if I turn it the other way?
Sisi?
Sisi.
Sisi. Oh, sure.
Sisi. Anyway. Anyway, Faisal has been in the show, but we're going to give him a hard time throughout the show because of his brevity.
How about David?
David Ignacio González Zamudio.
Where are the limits of religious freedom? Why is religion on the money, the schools, the political campaigns? Why is there only one candidate that is transparent about using humanism as a decision-making framework? Transhumanism, to be more specific. Let's talk about our transhumanist candidate here.
So that's a good one.
Is our transhumanist candidate, is he Republican or Democrat?
No.
Really? I'm
He's
surprised.
Neither.
What
He's
else
neither.
Is there?
He's neither. He belongs to the party, the Transhumanist Party. And he's been a guest of this show before, and his name is Zoltan Istvan. Mm-hmm. And that's easy for somebody else to say. But transhumanism is when, someone that advocates for the use of technology and science to radically change and improve the world and mm-hmm. humanity as a whole. So the idea... here is this candidate wants to use science and technology to actually make the country better. Mm-hmm. And so he's the only candidate. And so when you look, when you use those two tools, it doesn't mean you give away morality. It doesn't mean that you give away freedoms. It doesn't mean that you treat everybody as a robot. Mm-hmm. No, it means that you use more common sense and science and technology to arrive at what the truth is.
It's more of like, well, we have science and technology, and we're still relying on arts and humanities to do our thinking. Arts and humanities are great. I've got this huge thing. I'm doing a lot of research on like progressivism, and you know, I'm definitely consider myself a liberal in my thinking. But some of the ways that people make interpretations of data in a more of an I was an English major. It's all subjective, the mm-hmm. interpretations that they give to these ideas, where science and technology tries as hard as possible to be objective,
yes.
which I think that has produced a lot of really great outcomes. Well, Why don't we do that?
The best thing, it doesn't use magic. It doesn't use imaginary stuff, or it doesn't use supernatural things that may or may mm-hmm. not exist to make decisions on the lives, on the very real lives that we have. So mm-hmm. anyway, we have another caller.
Eva Quinones, hi.
Yes, hello, David.
Hello, thank you for calling the show.
How's everybody doing over there?
Pretty great. Good.
What do you think of this religion and politics that we have in the US nowadays?
Well, you know, it's a big problem down here.
Down where?
We're working hard.
Down where?
To make it, down in Puerto Rico, you know, we're making hard, work on the separation mm-hmm. issues, and there's victories in between, not so much victories, but I have to mention one of the big victories down here, and it is that, you know, after the Obergefell decision a few weeks ago, mm-hmm. we have homosexual weddings in Puerto Rico, oh. and our vice president, the vice president of Humanistas Seculares de Puerto Rico, Luis Ramos, He's a celebrant, and he was the celebrant of Puerto Rico's first wedding of two women. And he married yes. Yolanda Arroyo and Suna Oliveras. And it was a big thing in the media, and a very meaningful moment for all of us that promote separation of yeah. church and state. Hmm.
And it was a big deal. It was a big issue because there were a lot of people even after the Supreme Court came down, there were people fighting and saying that, well, Puerto Rico is not a state, and therefore we don't have to follow the Supreme Court.
Yeah, and, we have our own rules on.
And when the wedding took place, correct me if I'm mistaken, Eva, but when the wedding took place, they actually had to have security. In there to ensure, because there were so many people that were so terribly unhappy mm. that they couldn't push their beliefs onto a couple. I mean, I never understood how a gay marriage would affect a heterosexual couple in any way, shape, or form. Giving somebody else the rights, you know, the same rights and benefits that come with that contract, because it is a legal contract.
The problem is their marriage might be safe, but their kids might be brainwashed into being gay, and then
That's how one becomes gay.
Yeah, by seeing all these gay marriages.
By seeing gay marriage. I wonder how gay people became gay to start with.
I mean,
without the marriages.
I have a hypothesis about the reason why so many Christians actively don't want same-sex people to marry each other. And I think it is not just because, oh, the children are going to learn to be homosexuals. No, what they will learn is tolerance, obviously. But no, what I really think is that you are protecting everybody if you prevent others from doing something that you think is sinful. Mm-hmm. So their opposition to this kind of issues about separation and secularization of government is more like something that they do to they oppose to protect the island from hurricanes, from bad luck, from God
magic
protecting yeah. everybody. It's more like a protection of everybody. Of course, it's not true. Of course, it's absolute, you know, holy. But I think that is the main reason. Also, you want to have everybody everybody behave as if they believe the same thing as you. And this is a way of making everybody behave as if they believe what you believe.
I definitely agree.
The thing is that, yeah, they had security. I'm not aware that there was any active opposition outside of the venue. It was a very small ceremony. But the protection, obviously, in case something happened, I don't think anything really would have happened.
Good to prevent.
People are not as violent in that sense down here. It's not like they were going to have a shooter or something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway, you never know. I mean, when you go to the movies and you don't expect somebody to get up and shoot you, in the back of your head, like it happened a few days ago in one of the theaters here, with a fellow who was at Tea Party. And let me point out that shooter was not an illegal immigrant. From Mexico.
It was a Tea Partier, I hear.
Anyway, but I have to commend the humanists of Puerto Rico who have worked very, very tirelessly, as I've mentioned many times on this show. It is important to us here in the United States because Puerto Rico is the United States. It is part of the United States. It's a U.S. territory, an American law, mm-hmm. and every Puerto Rican is an American citizen by birth. And so we can't have laws in the mainland and laws that don't apply over there. Mm-hmm. So Eva, one last question before we let you go so we can see if we can get someone else. How do you feel about Trump's comments? And all the things that he's been doing and saying.
Well, I am the kind of person that says that the more I know, the better off I am. So I really want to hear just people say what they really think, so I can evaluate them personally, and also so I can evaluate those that agree with him. So this is all information. It's good for everybody. The more we know, the better we can decide. And if we know he thinks those things, well, it's democracy benefits from freedom of speech. And sometimes you need like a big mouth to say things because it puts everything else in perspective, mm-hmm. and forces us to evaluate what is really important in our leaders.
And that's the fear that a lot of other candidates have, that they're going to bring up topics that they don't want to talk about. I mean, I mentioned before immigration, so science, immigration. You know, whether or not you believe in a creation universe or a science, a Big Bang kind of theory, that kind of stuff. So I agree with you. I think the more clearer and the more people talk and say things, especially if they're saying not what people want to hear, but they're saying exactly how they feel themselves, then it shows in a way leadership, because they're not just following what the crowd is saying. Tell us what we want to hear, although that's what they want to do, obviously, to get the votes, to get elected. But I think it's a more honest way of seeing the true colors of people. I don't think we get that a lot.
And I think that a lot of people will roll their eyes and say, well, that's kind of a naive, what's the word when you think an idealistic way to look at things, but there are places where it's better. I read through Ayaan Hirsi Ali's book, which
Infidel.
Details, Infidel, yeah. It's the one that details like her entire life story. And one of the things that she got over in Holland was a platform to speak about her views. There was still conflict. There were still people who were just all like, please be quiet. Like, you don't know what you're talking about. You're anti-Islam and you're a bigot, and still people trying to kill her and stuff like that. But at the same time, the political sphere that she was in was allowing her to say these things and protecting her for her right to say them, and voted her in even though she was saying these things.
Okay.
You know, and I think that's the kind of political world I want to see in the United States.
Okay, Eva, thank you so much for the call. We're going to read another question from Patricia Urbina. I assume she's Latin. No, actually, I think she is. But she says, and I think this brings us sort of that intersection we're talking about. In regards to your post about air discussion, Jesus was not involved in politics. One case that he stated this himself in the Bible can be found in John 18:36. So this is more for the Christians. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, John 6:15, he was going to be forced to be king, and he hid in the mountains. She's had some debates with some professors on this, but basically it's been really since the 1950s, she says, that religion seems to be pushing more and more into our currency, which David Ignacio also mentioned. And so what do you think of, you think the religion is being pushed back now, or do you still see religion moving forward into our government?
I think that religion is definitely still has a hold in our government, but I would like to say something about that comment. I think I've actually commented on one of your Facebook posts before concerning this, but I totally agree.
Oh, that was you.
Yeah.
No,
this wasn't me, but...
No, you're the comment.
Shut up. But I firmly believe that Jesus just stayed out of politics. I mean, when the Jewish leaders...
Assuming he existed.
Yeah. Well, okay. I mean, as a character in the story, he was stayed out of politics. When the Jewish leaders came to him...
And
they asked him, okay, should we be... He was trying to rope Jesus into this conversation about politics. He was like, should the Jewish temples pay taxes to Caesar? Should we have to pay taxes to our federal government? And there's a lot more in depth about it. There's a lot more nuance to it. But he said, give me one of those coins. Mm-hmm. Whose face is on this coin?
Caesar.
Caesar's. Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God. When I was a Christian, I was hardcore, no. Like, we do not get involved in politics. Yeah. The group I was a part of was just all like, if you get involved in politics, you're not giving to God what is God. Give them your vote, but then move on.
Now,
and I think that that's a beneficial
so in
way
the 1950s,
to look at it.
In the 1950s, when we had In God We Trust, changed from E Pluribus Unum, as the slogan for the country, when we, they inserted in the Pledge of Allegiance, One Nation Under God, that was the fear of the gutless communism. And so that fear is no longer here. But then in the the first president was a Democrat. It was before Reagan, I just went blank. Anyway, Jimmy Carter was the first religious person that we got. He was, Southern Baptist, very religious guy. Mm-hmm. And we had, but then Ronald Reagan came in and he brought in the moral majority. He brought in, the religious breakfast. He brought in the, prayer into the White House. Not to mention that they also had some psychic reader ball and stuff. But bottom line is that religion started getting a foothold and realizing with that comes more power. And so then we got this now where any church that wants money from the government to treat, feed the hungry or do something like that, you have your faith-based initiatives that have absolutely no control. They have no way, you can use it to proselytize and no one can go and audit the books because by law, the churches cannot have their books audited by the government. That's why they have $6 million houses and $55 million airplanes. Mm. So I think that a lot of the smaller churches realize, and in fact, if you go to the American Separation for Church and State, the leadership of that organization is mostly religious people. There are people,
that is true.
They want separation of church and state because we've already know what happens when the two get together. A little thing called
the
Inquisition
Catholic
and yes.
The Dark Ages. They're considered the Dark Ages.
Exactly.
I read a book once, and the book at the very beginning of it was just like, Catholics believe that their Dark Ages was actually the Light Ages. Those are the good old days. There was literally a book that started out saying it was a Catholic book. It was interesting.
All right. Anyway. Well, we have about 5 minutes left. So, Patricia, Urbina, thank you. I want to bring up another topic, and that is one. Let's talk about the other candidates. It doesn't look like we're picking just on the Republicans. Bernie Sanders is, as I said, is becoming
socialist
very popular.
Communist. Sorry.
Yeah, he's a socialist communist guy. But there's something I disagree with him. He treats GMOs as if they were bad things. He wants GMOs labeled, and he's very much into the GMO thing.
Well, that's a lot of liberals.
Yes, and it's usually misinformation. We as humans have been changing the genetic makeup of corn, they're not naturally existing cows anywhere, bananas. Just about everything that we consume, every animal that we eat, chickens and things, all of those things have been created by human manipulation of the genome of those species. And that is GMO. That's exactly. Now, with the, today's technology, we can actually be far more accurate. We can actually do things, and there are tests, and there are things, there are ways to prove, but more people have eaten GMO food in the last 10 years than ever without any consequence. And so with the problem with this, that I see with this, is it creates this mythological food that is, oh, it's not healthy, and you know, you need to label it so I can choose whether to eat it or not to eat it. The problem is that it creates this fantasy that there's a difference when there isn't, and then people in Africa that are starving, and people in countries that they need the food, when we go give them food, they're like, oh no, you're trying to give us that GMO stuff. You're trying to poison us. Oh, America, trying to destroy us. And so you see, it kills people, actually. Mm. So that's why I see that as something, you know, more faith. It's again, it's without evidence. This is when I say our skepticism needs to kick in and be skeptical about it and ask the questions. If it is, what is it? Mm. Let's show about it. This has gone, there are a lot of people that want this to go to Congress and vote on it. Mm. So that is one thing. The next person is Hillary Clinton. She is the leader of the Democratic Party.
Yeah.
What's your take on her?
I don't know. Like I said before, like I'm
We'd like
not...
to see a woman become a president. I mean,
I don't think that we should value that over anything. I think that
no.
I think if a woman becomes president, I think it should be completely on her own merit.
Absolutely.
And we should not even be thinking about whether she has a vagina.
For anybody.
Honestly.
For anybody. We want the best person that we can get.
It irritates me to death when people are just like, we need a woman president. No, we need a president that is good. Yeah. And if she happens to have a vagina, that's great.
So it is.
I want that kind of president.
Part of the problem is when you look historically and you never see any at all, it says, really? The entire country doesn't have a woman that is capable or, you know, I mean, we already have CEOs and we have all kinds of astronauts. We have all kinds of people.
It's not even about capability. It's about who is running and whether or not the people who are running actually are legitimate. I mean, there are countries that we know are not the best places for women president, for women. Benazir is a friend of mine. She was named after the first woman president of Pakistan.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean you want to be a woman in Pakistan.
Yes.
So I'm just
saying, because
we haven't had a woman president doesn't mean that the United States isn't a really great place to be for a woman.
Yes, absolutely. No. It just means that there may be. Now, another criticism that I've heard about Hillary Clinton is that she's part of the establishment. She's part of the political machine. She gets money from a lot of big organizations like anybody else.
There's been so many scandals. I'm just saying.
Tons of scandals.
Swooning fits when we need her.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, the thing is, it might be distracting, and that's the thing. So she comes from she's her husband was president. She's been exposed to a lot. She knows a lot. She's a smart woman. But she does have a lot of people that hate her guts with a passion. And so it may be that she is not, you know, that she may not be the right person. Now, she kisses the right religious ass. She meets with the right people.
She flip-flops on the whole gay rights issue.
You could like to think that she grew it, you know, that she grew personally, but yeah, that's considered flip-flopping.
I don't know.
And maybe it is. When it comes to religion, I think she would continue the status quo. She certainly doesn't want to fight religion. She certainly doesn't want to question it.
Mm-hmm.
I think Bernie Sanders would definitely look at things different. And again, our transhumanist, Sultan Izvan, will also. So we only have a few seconds left in the show, and I want to thank all of you that called. I want to thank you for being here.
Yeah, it was fun hanging out with you. I always love doing a show together. I feel like we have a good vibe.
Yes, the only thing missing is some wine, but everything is great. So thank you so much, everyone, and we look forward to seeing you again next time.
All right.